Is it possible to have a healthy sleep life without the regularities? I say that because I'm all over the place and I've gotten good in being all over the place. So I'll often, like what happens, I'll go stretches of time. There'll be sometimes a month where my days are like, this is embarrassing to admit, but they're
It's
like,
just you and I here,
exactly.
Lex. Just you and I.
It's like 28 hours or 30 hour days.
Yeah.
Like I'll just go all the way around comfortably and happily. I love it. And then there'll be a nap. I mean, if you like add up the hours when I'm just like sleeping as much as I want, it'll probably be like 6 hour average per 24 hours. Like that kind of, so it works out nicely. Maybe even 7 hours, I don't know, but that it's obviously irregular and there's chaos in the whole thing. Like sometimes it's shorter sleep, sometimes it's longer. Is that totally not a good thing, do you think?
The best evidence that we have to speak to this question is people who are doing rotating shifts. And unfortunately, the news is not good. They usually have a higher incidence of many diseases such as depression, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, obesity, stroke. And again, that's just me communicating the data that we have, and I'm not telling you that you should do anything different. The other thing is that there's nothing in your biology that suggests that that's how your body was designed to sleep. It is a system that loves habit. If your circadian clock in your brain, it's called the suprachiasmatic nucleus, sits in the middle of your brain, had a personality trait, it would be a creature of habit. It loves habit. That's how your biology is designed to work, is through very archetypal, prototypical, expected cycles. And when we do something different to that, then you start to see some of the pressure, stress, fractures in the system. But again, to your point, if that's something that you don't mind, adopting and understanding, and then I think you should keep doing what you're
Yeah,
doing.
it's complicated. You of course have to be a student of your own body and explore it. One of the reasons I want to have kids is kids enforce a stricter schedule. I think I definitely
So I've
keep
heard.
I definitely feel that I'm not living the sort of data-wise, scientifically speaking, the optimal life. And me just living the way I want to live day to day is perhaps not the optimal way. And there's certain things that I've seen very successful people that I know in my life when they have kids, they actually their productivity goes up, they get their shit together. There's a lot of aspects that
Regularity, yeah.
the regularity, I mean that creatures a habit, that's the thing. That's power. And then you start to optimally use the hours you have in the day. Let me ask you about
Well,
diet.
actually,
Oh,
I just
sure.
have one quick point on that too. We often think about sleep as a cost, but instead, I think of sleep as an investment. And the reason is because your effectiveness and your efficiency when you're well slept typically exceeds that when you're not. And to me, it's the idea of if I'm going to boil a pot of water, why would I boil it on medium when I could boil it in half the time on high? And I sometimes worry that when I speak to Fortune 500 companies and, they're of this mentality of, long hours, getting people to rise and grind. The first point is that after about 20 hours of being awake, a human being is as cognitively as impaired as they would be if they were legally drunk. And the reason I bring that point up is because I don't know any company or CEO who would say, I've got this great team, they're drunk all the time. But we often laud the airport warrior who's flown through three different time zones in the past 2 days, is on email at 2 a.m. and then is, you know, in the office at six. And I think there is some aspect, not in all people, but there is sort of some aspect of that sort of slight sleep machismo. And that's not what you are, very different. You know, you are driven by a purity of passion and a very authentic, incredibly genuine goal of wanting to do something remarkable with your life. That's not the issue I think I'm speaking about. It's just simply that I think this notion of wanting to be awake for longer to try and get more done,
right,
can sometimes be at odds with the fact that you can actually get so much more done, mm-hmm, if you're well slept. And it's this trade-off.
I actually admire people that take the big risk and work hard, whether that means staying up late at night, all those kinds of things. But it cannot be in the framework, in the context, like what Edison said, which is sleep feels like a waste of time. So like, if you're not sleeping because you think sleep is stupid, that's totally wrong. But if you're not sleeping because you're deeply passionate about something, that to me, it's a gray area, of course, but that to me is much more admirable. And it's everything you're espousing is saying, like, whatever the hell you're doing, you better be aware that sleep long-term and short-term is really good for you. So if you're not sleeping, you're sacrificing, just make sure you're sacrificing for the right thing. I see vodka and getting drunk the same way. I know it's not good for me. I know I'm not going to feel good days after. I know it's going to decrease my performance. And there's nothing positive about it, except it introduces chaos in my life, that introduces beautiful experiences that I would not otherwise have. It creates like this turmoil of social interaction that ultimately makes me happy that I've experienced them in the moment, and later the stories, you get to meet new people. It's like alcohol in this society is a incredible facilitator of that. So like, that's a good example of like not sleeping and drinking way too much vodka.
And again, it's this notion of, you know, life is to be lived to a degree. But you know, if you do have children, I think one of the other things that then maybe comes into the picture is the fact that now there are other people that you have to live for than yourself.
Yeah, but come on. Like, once they're old enough, like, if you can't defend for yourself, you're too weak. Get stronger.
It's going to be that kind of fatherhood.
Yeah.
I got it. I'm understanding so much more about Lex Fridman than
why you have to have for me, that would be, my wife would be probably softer. It's good cop, bad cop, because I think I'm but of course, actually, because I don't have kids, I've seen some tough dudes when they have kids become the softies. Become like, they do everything for their kids, and it become like it totally transforms their life. I mean, Joe Rogan is an example of that. I've just seen so many tough guys completely become changed by having kids, which is fascinating to watch, because it just shows you how meaningful having kids is for a lot of people.
Although I would say, having chatted with Joe for some time, I think he is a delightful sweetheart, independent of children. I think, don't get me wrong, I don't want to be in a ring with him. He would face me five ways till Tuesday. But I think he's a desperately sweet man and a very, very smart individual.
Yeah. I mean, but he talks about the compassion he's gained from realizing, just watching kids grow up, that we were all kids at some point. You get a new perspective. I think, just like me, I still get this with him. He's super competitive, and like, there's a certain way to approach life. Like, you're striving to do great things and you're competitive against others, and that intensity or that aggression, that can lack compassion sometimes and empathy. And when you have children, you get a sense like, oh, everybody was a child at some point. Everybody was a kid. And you see that whole development process. It can definitely enrich, expand your ability to be empathetic